and Jerome.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this Mayor and City Council for Monday, March 4th at 5:45. First thing on our agenda is I need a motion to go to closed session to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom it has jurisdiction, or any other personal matter that affects one or more specific individuals. I can't talk. And consult with counsel to obtain legal advice. Councilmember Simak.
Motion to go to closed session.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Knight to go to closed session. All those in favor? Vote is 5 in favor with Councilmembers Matresic and Councilmember Pillis absent. We'll be back at 6 o'clock. Thank you. Thank you, Kelly. Yeah. All right. All right. Hello, everyone. Kelly, are we ready?
We are ready.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this Mayor and City Council meeting for Monday, March 4th. Prior to this open session of Mayor and City Council, we had a closed session. Topics of discussion were legal and personal matters. And also, the mayor brought to us a board appointment for the Board of Zoning Appeals, Marsha Rigsby. And so persons present were Mayor Rick Meehan, City Manager David Recor, Council President Lloyd Martin, Council Secretary Mary Knight, Councilmember Doug Simak, Brent Ashley, Dennis Dare, and Joe Matresic, City Solicitor Guy Ayers, and Kelly Allman. And there was a motion made by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresic to close the meeting. The motion was 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. And I would ask you all to please rise for the prayer and stay standing for the pledge. And prayer will be given by Joe Groves. Joe, welcome.
Let us pray. Good and gracious Father, we thank you for this day. We ask that your blessings fall down upon this council. We ask you to bless them and their work. We ask that you bless this entire community. And we pray this prayer as we pray every prayer in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Could you listen to prayer?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.
Change things up a little bit. Councilmember Matresic.
I'd like to go ahead and make a motion that we approve the appointment of Marsha Rigsby to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Councilmember Simak.
I'll second that motion.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresic and a second by Councilmember Simak to approve Marsha Rigsby for the Board of Zoning Appeals. All those in favor? The vote is 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Marsha, would you come on up and get sworn in tonight? Be our pleasure.
Since we have Marsha here, we're not going to let her get away. We're going to go ahead and swear her in right away. As you know, we have many boards that citizens serve on in Ocean City, and of course they're all very important, but one of the most important is the Board of Zoning Appeals. And Marsha, I think, is very qualified for that position. We're very happy that she's agreed to serve on that board. It's an honor to have all of our citizens participate, and this is one of the instances where it's very important for all of us to have a well-managed board. So Marsha, what I'm going to do is I'm going to swear you in, and all you have to do is raise your right hand, look at me, don't laugh, and you repeat after me. You say your name where I say mine, okay?
Okay.
I, Rick Meehan.
I'm Marsha Rigsby.
Do swear. That I will be faithful and bear true allegiance.
That I will be faithful and bear true allegiance.
To the state of Maryland.
To the state of Maryland.
And support the Constitution and laws thereof.
And support the Constitution and laws thereof.
And that I will.
And that I will.
To the best of my skill and judgment.
To the best of my skill and judgment.
Diligently and faithfully.
Diligently and faithfully.
Without partiality or prejudice.
Without partiality or prejudice.
Execute the office of Board of Zoning Appeals.
Execute the office of Board of Zoning Appeals.
For the town of Ocean City, Maryland.
For the town of Ocean City, Maryland.
According to the Constitution of this state.
According to the Constitution of this state.
Congratulations, and thank you very much. I'm going to have you sign on the dotted line. Correct it, would you please?
I
Thank you again. Thank you all.
Marsha, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. All right. Okay. Next on the agenda is approval of minutes and their work session dated February 12, 2013, and regular session number 3 dated February 19, 2013. We'll consider them approved if there are no corrections, additions, or deletions. All right. Moving on an agenda, we're basically going to move to the public comments from the citizens. We kind of move this around a little bit, and basically it's any person who may wish to speak on any matter at the regular session may be heard during the comments from the public for a period of 3 minutes or such time as may be deemed appropriate by the council president. Anyone wishing to be heard shall state their name, address, and the subject on which he or she wishes to speak. Yes, sir. Come on up to the podium.
Tony Crist, 403 Bayshore Drive, Bay Vista, number 18. Good evening. I want to address a couple questions regarding the finances of the city to the council, and I want to repeat a suggestion I made earlier. The question for Mr. Mayor,
Make sure you address me, and we'll work on that, okay?
Oh, you want me to address you?
Okay. Yes, okay.
Do any of you know the number of the current numerical number of the current obligations of the city of Ocean City, and could you share it with me if you do? No. Any of you?
Not right off hand, Tony, I don't.
No. Well, for the exact number, I'd ask our budget manager.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Whether she's prepared or not.
You know, go ahead, Tony. Anything else?
We can certainly get that information.
Right.
You can?
Yeah.
Without an audit? Okay. Who?
I think
Ginny? Well, I don't. I mean, I just want an answer. Does Ginny know the number?
I don't know the exact number.
No.
And you want an exact number, so I think that why don't you allow us to get that for you?
Well, they're actually, Mr. Mayor, is probably a range. Okay. There is a range that will tell the council what the current obligations of the city are. And if it's going to be provided by staff, I'd like it to be totally explained, please. And I just think you need to know that. And I want to repeat that I think you ought to seriously have an audit of the books and records to protect yourselves and protect the city. And the thing that's done, and my 3 minutes aren't up yet.
No, you're fine.
the thing that's done with that gentleman that comes up here, if you read his letter, is not an audit. I don't want to break that news. If it's news to anybody, it's not an audit. It's called a perfunctory audit. It is not an audit. And it scares me to death, not having my livelihood directly dependent on it, but indirectly tied to it. But many, many do. Not to know the answer to that question. So I would really think it's worthwhile to spend a little time finding it out for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
David, I know that number encompasses a number of different line items and different things, so different funds throughout the budget. So if we could get that number for Mr. Chris.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, ladies. My theme here this evening is to try to reduce bars in Ocean City. Mr. Mayor,
can you address me as far as pop?
You?
Okay. Yes, please.
Okay.
I don't want anybody picking on anybody from the audience.
No problem, Mr. Martin.
Thank you.
Mr. Martin, since the mayor's been in office in Ocean City, the bars have increased from 80 to 131.
The names of them for me?
Pardon?
You have the names of all them for me?
I can get them.
Okay.
I sure can.
Thank you.
Mr. Martin, could I get help to bring back the kids back to Ocean City?
We try. Pop, you know what? It's funny because you keep on asking. You're going to ask all these questions. I might as well try to answer them for you.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. We're trying to bring all the kids back. This is a family resort. We have Play It Safe. They work real hard in June to bring the kids here.
You think the age would be 4 to bring them back?
I'm sorry?
Do you think the age would be 4 to drink to bring them back?
Before they drink.
Sir?
Did you drink when you were 16, Pop?
No.
Okay. Then we try to let our kids drink before they're under the age of 21, so.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm seriously bringing back blue collar workers and children, which were the heart of Ocean City. I would challenge the council to reduce the bar dependency, and furthermore, I will be back from getting the support of the pastors, the ministers, and priests demanding reducing the bars in Ocean City. Mr. Martin, the blue-collar workers are the heart of Ocean City and always been. I would hope the council would take my request with solid proposals because voters of Ocean City are in support of this. Finally, if this council ignores this at their own risk, I'll be back in 2 weeks contacting newspapers and voters who put you all in office. Mr. Martin, since mayor's been in office, Ocean City is number one bars in America of this small community. And I would like to say thank you and the council for your cooperation, and may the hinges of friendship never get rusty.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else in the audience? Yes, sir.
Joe Grove, 1669 Street, Ocean City, Maryland. Mr. Mayor, Mr. President, City Council members, and Mr. Recor, let me begin by thanking each of you for your service and your willingness to serve we the people. I want to especially thank the citizens that are here tonight that have taken time out of their schedule to be here. It truly shows that we have a town that is active and wants to participate with our government. Tonight, I want to discuss the formation and the revival of our city committees. And I make this promise up front that I intend to keep my talk positive. I believe it is imperative that we all stay positive and we learn to work together. In my first speech before this council, I said that we needed to learn to work like the days of Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill, where they learned to disagree and to come to a consensus and do what was best for the people. In November of 2012, the citizens of this great town spoke loud and clear for a new direction. There was a total of 10,991 votes for city council seats. Who would have ever believed that many votes would have been cast in this town? The two members that no longer sit on this council received the total votes of 1,735. And when we look at those numbers, it tells us that 85% of the people in this town voted for a different direction. I do not bring this up to rub anyone's nose in the results of the election. It is brought up to show the overwhelming call for a new direction. So we have that new direction, and we finally have our citizens' committees back. These committees will give us the opportunity to brainstorm and work together to improve this town and government. Even our new city manager must see the value in committees. Just a few weeks ago, he invited over 100 citizens, former council members, and business leaders to the convention center to be part of his strategic plan. The group was broken into small groups / committees to brainstorm and to present their ideas to help develop this plan. It was well planned and a great night for Ocean City. I personally thank you, David, for the opportunity to be part of that. You see, whether you're a city manager, a major business leader, or any other successful person, you understand the importance of citizens and employees to have the right to gather and brainstorm. If you truly understand how brainstorming is done, it brings forth great ideas that help any organization. I have been told that two council members, Mr. President, wanted to disband as part of the past council every committee because it wasn't in the public's eye. I would tell you that first, it is hard for any entire committee to report to a council, and that fact every committee meeting should and is open to the public, and every report given to this council is open to the public. Every supporting document you receive is available to the public. Rumor has
as it spreads in this town, and I've been told that every council member was asked to serve on one of these new committees, and that two of the council members have refused or are unwilling to serve on these committees. I would truly hope in my heart, as do most of these citizens here today, that this is not true. I would hope that as public servants, that you understand that you are here to serve we, the people. A short 15 months ago, I stated that a sleeping giant was awakened. I want you to understand that that giant hasn't fallen asleep. It is alive and well and filled with energy to continue to educate and keep the citizens of this great town informed. I plead with the two that will not serve on committees to reconsider. It is your job to serve the people of this town, and remember that the majority of this people in this town asks for a new direction. In closing, the citizens, and I especially, want to work with all seven of you and the mayor. However, we cannot do that if you are not willing to come to the table and sit with us. So the invite is there. And I would ask those that do not wish to serve to not ignore the voice of the people. I thank you, and I ask that God bless this council and this town. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. All right. Anyone else in the public that speak? Yes, sir.
John Atkins, 8802 Caribbean Drive, Ocean City. I would like first to thank the council for changing the ability to speak at a work session. That was the other week, and that was the first time, and I thank you all for that. The other thing, I just want to remind you that after our election, I suggested that we look into letting the county handle that, got more voting machines, and changing the date to November election, because you can look at what the city in Salisbury primary was. And you got to admit, ours was a whole lot more than that. Okay? Just keep that so it doesn't wait to the last minute on how we do that. Whether we have to have the legislature's approval to change it for the county to accept and put it all on one ballot at one location, one time. The other thing, I was looking at your packet, and I noticed that there's over $1 million that comes out of the general fund for the transportation. Having driven the bus for a lot of years, most people think we make millions of dollars off the bus system. You know, they have that idea, and we used to charge $1 now, to $2, now it's $3, but it's still a bargain. But most people, even some of the citizens here, do not know that we take money out of the general fund, even though we're subsidized by the federal and state transportation departments. I hate to say that we ought to let people know, but we should, because it's funded by the citizens of Ocean City. And I think everybody should get to know that. It does cost us a lot of money to fund that transportation system. Thank you.
Thanks, Frank. Thanks for your comments on everything. Thank you. Anybody else in the audience would like to speak? Yes, ma'am. Come on up.
Ellie Diggleman, Ocean City, Maryland. In response to Joe Groh's announcements and all, wow, I'm really impressed. A whole 100 citizens were invited to the strategic planning meeting out of 10,000. That's very, very impressive. Concerning the union contracts that were in the papers this past week, I'd just like to say congratulations to the current Council Majority 5 on fulfilling your ugly promises to further force...
Excuse me. We're not here to get her beat up, okay?
This is my time to say what I feel and what I think and where my tax dollars are going.
Let's keep it respectful.
To further force impossibly reckless taxing, spending, and double-edged censorship on Ocean City's citizens, voters, property-owning taxpayers, and visiting tourists. Go ahead, pat yourselves on the back. I've tried to tell you in the past that if everybody doesn't win, then nobody wins. And you guys are killing the goose that lays the golden eggs. That's the taxpayers. And I don't mean just the resident taxpayers. I'm talking about the absentee property owners as well. Secondly, thank you for limiting us to 3 minutes. I guess 5 minutes wasn't condescending enough, huh? Three, be reminded that we are neither children nor idiots. Be reminded also that all of you were elected to represent us, not anointed to rule over us. And see, it's our money we are spending, not your money that we're spending. If it were, you'd be kicking and screaming. Four, also relevant to this new censorship protocol, if you're going to require that the public to do your homework before meetings, then the agenda packet information needs to be consistently and accurately provided to the public in PDF format on the previous Friday afternoon when the agenda is publicly posted on the website and emailed out to the public with white-only PowerPoint page backgrounds, no colors. This other format, scribbed or scribed, is a horrendous mockery to the public. Spitting in our faces would be less insulting. If this is accidental, then it can only be considered incompetence. Otherwise, it's intentional. Five, finally, the televised meeting airings scheduled for 10 in the morning and 7 in the evening daily are starting at least 10 minutes early. Can that please be corrected one way or the other? Meaning that either announce that they're going to come on at 10 of the hour or make sure that they don't come on until the top of the hour. Tonight's agenda items, the public hearing, the annual transportation, there I have information. I guess we'll be able to talk on that separately.
We'll speak at the hearing.
The city solicitor items, 11A, the second reading should be clarified for ease in adhering on the non-soliciting on from 27th Street south and east of Baltimore Avenue. It needs to be specified that it's anywhere within a block of the boardwalk if you expect people to adhere by that legislation. So if you can keep that in mind when you discuss that. 11C, the first ordinance, first reading on the ordinance to amend the miniature golf, to permit miniature golf as a conditional use in the downtown mixed-use zoning district. I respectfully request that you oppose it based on it being a low-impact commercial use. Can you think of anything that has a higher impact on a neighborhood than miniature golf? The project for which this change is being made is replacing a city block worth of, I think it's replacing a city block worth of parking spaces with a miniature golf course. How are all those parking spaces being replaced, or are they? I'm assuming not. 11E, the four trolleys for $26,760 that we'd be selling, I think they ought to be given first refusal to local businesses before you put them on the general market, and not necessarily just HMRA members. And then finally, 11F, asking the Maryland Transit Maryland Transit Authority for grants. You have it listed as Maryland Transit something else. But the Maryland Transit Authority, which is the transportation quote-unquote trust fund, has no money. I don't know how we're going to get grants out of an agency that doesn't have any money. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Anyone else in the audience? Yes, sir.
Joseph B. Cryer,
yep.
709 Gulfstream Drive, Ocean City, Maryland.
Thank you.
I ran for public office. Public office is a thankless profession. So everybody, you know, you be critical. If you want to be critical enough, not at the lady who just spoke, run for office. Trust me. It's very painful. So I think the kids are doing a great job. I think the board is doing a great job. And, I am blessed that I saw Dennis, he asked me to come here today because of the committee issue, because I think that's a huge issue. And I'm disappointed Margaret's not here, because she's obviously a player in the whole deal. So as we move forward, I'm retired. So if you need me to work in any capacity as a volunteer, put my name on the ballot, I'm there for you. Okay? But it's so easy to criticize everybody when you're not in the line of fire. Comprende?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Herb, come on up.
Harry Parkwood, Skatewood Section, Austin City. Good evening. Welcome back, Joel. First, Comcast. They give us here a little unit to put behind our TV for digital TV.
Yes, sir.
They said it was for free. Now they are charging us $1.99 each plus tax.
I understand. Yeah, I heard about it today, too, as well. So, yes, sir. I don't know anything else about it, but... Yeah.
You'd have to Comcast. Yeah. Now, the solid waste. I was at a meeting, and I watched TV. They say that they want the residents to pay for solid waste pickup. For what? What happened to all that $1.5 million, $1.75 million that I brought to this town to ship to Chester, Pennsylvania to save it? What happened to the... 1 day a week in the fall, I brought. What happened to 7 days pickup for the business people? I got it down to five. Where's all that impact money going?
Well, I think, Herb, what you heard is we're going to have a meeting on March 19th to look at other ways, other revenue streams for the town of Ocean City. And I think the city manager actually brought up a bunch of things that the staff had brought to him, that we would have a discussions for that day as a topic. None of the ones that you just said have been thrown out there whether we're going to do them yet. So I want you to know that. All right? And you're welcome to come to the meeting on March 19th. Because, you know, your public comment will be welcome at the same time. So go ahead.
All right. Now, I wasn't here, but Joe Grove said, Mayor, you're the best mayor we ever had. I don't know about that.
You agree, too?
Pardon?
You agree with Joe? No, but
he's a good speaker. Good speaker, very good. And we agree we're both Cleveland Brown football fans. But I said something one day when the 043 was here that they're doing a good job. The mayor took a tantrum. Mayor, you don't remember?
Sorry, I don't.
You don't remember? I was sitting over here. You were talking to a gentleman who was in a wheelchair. And you was arguing, you're going to pay that $1 million?
Or make sure make sure you speak right here to me, okay? And because I don't want you picking on any person in the council, okay? And we want to keep your comments as you go along, okay?
Yeah. All right. And you're taking my freedom of speech away for end of the council meetings. How am I going to talk to anything on the agenda? I don't know what you're going to talk about. Like John Atkins says, he takes notes. I take notes up in the air. I remember. What's he going to talk about when you come up here and speak like now? We know what you're going to talk about. Speak on the agenda and let the public at the end of the meeting or during the meeting speak on that agenda, which would be perfect. Right. And stop taking the people's freedom of speech away.
Well, I'm not trying to do that.
All right.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else in the public, any audience would like to speak? Okay.
Well, that went well.
All right. Moving on. Next on the agenda is items presented by the Mayor and City Council. It's the appointment of council committees and commissions presented by Mayor Meehan.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Yes, sir.
At the council meeting of January 29th, the council voted to reinstate the Mayor and City Council legislative committees and commissions. And at that meeting, the council president asked that all council members let me know what committees or commissions they may be interested in serving upon. I would then present that to the Mayor and City Council, and the council could then confirm those appointments to the committees and commissions. The committees and commissions were the same that were in place in 2010. What I've done, and I've presented that to the council, it's also in the packet. If anybody did take the time to download the packet or look at the packet before they came to tonight's meeting, and they would see who they are. And I'll go ahead if you want me to read them into the record, Mr. President.
Yes.
With the Police Commission, Mayor Rick Meehan, Councilman Doug Simak, Council President Lloyd Martin, Councilman Dennis Dare. the noise board liaison, I spelled it wrong, nobody's gotten to me yet about that, Councilman Doug Simak, with an alternate being Council President Lloyd Martin, so we can make sure we do have somebody at the noise board meetings. I know Councilman Ashley, who served for a long period of time as a citizen representative on that committee, noted that sometimes there wasn't a council representative there. So with an appointee and an alternate, we hope to make sure we can rectify that situation. Beach Mediation Committee, Councilman Joe Matresik, with an alternate Council Secretary Mary Knight. Tri-County Council, Mayor Rick Meehan, Councilman Joe Matresik. Americans with Disabilities, which is a committee that has council representation. Councilmember Mary Knight served on that before, I believe, and has suggested that she would like to serve on that again. Recreation and Parks Committee, be Councilman Dennis Dare, Council President Martin, Councilman Joe Matresik. Tourism Commission, Mayor Rick Meehan, Councilmember Mary Knight, Councilman Dennis Dare, Councilman Joe Matresik. Pension Committee, Mayor Rick Meehan, Council President Martin. Risk Retention Committee, Councilman Doug Simak, with an alternate being Councilman Dennis Dare. Humane Society Committee, if it meets, we've always had it as a standing committee. The mayor has always served on that committee, Mayor Rick Meehan, Councilmember Mary Knight, Councilman Dennis Dare. Coastal Resources Legislative Committee, Councilmember Mary Knight. Then Maryland Coastal Bays Foundation Board of Directors. Actually, we've already appointed Hal Atkins to represent the town in that position. So I noted Dennis Dare to be an alternate. Hal thought that was great. So we will continue with Mr. Atkins as our appointment to that committee. Also serving, and I'll just for the notes here so everybody knows, on the Tourism Commission will also be one representative from the Hotel Motel Restaurant Association, one representative from the Ocean City Chamber of Commerce, one representative from the Economic Development Committee, one representative from the Ocean City Development Corporation, and the chairperson of the State Tourism Commission, who's a non-voting member, that is Greg Shockley. Also included in those meetings will be the city manager, the director of tourism, the director of the convention center, representative from Ocean City Special Events, executive director of the HMRA, and the executive director of the Chamber of Commerce, and any other department head that's requested to be there through the city manager. The police commission meetings will also include the city manager, the chief of police, and again, any other city employees requested to be there through the city manager. Parks and Recreation Advisory Board also includes the city manager, director of Parks and Recreation, and again, any city employees that may be requested to be there through the city manager. A council chairperson will be chosen for each committee. Agendas for these meetings will be prepared by the commission or committee chairperson and the department heads. Minutes of these meetings will be taken and placed on the agenda at a regularly scheduled meeting of the mayor and council and reported to the other members and the public by the chairperson. Meetings will be open to the public and the press. Closed session guidelines will be followed. If you could move forward with that, Mr. President, then I have a citizens committee to appoint as well.
I have some lights on here. Councilmember Simak.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion that we move forward with the mayor's recommendations.
All right. Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
All right.
I have a question.
Okay. I have a motion. I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Matresik. Councilmember Ashley.
Mayor, this question here on the Tourism Commission, for example, one representative from the HMRA, one from the Chamber. Who will pick those?
They will pick their own representative.
Thank you.
All right. Mary, you on?
No, I was on for a second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? The vote is 5 in favor.
Yes.
With 1 in opposition, and with Councilmember Ashley in opposition and Councilmember Pillis absent. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. All right.
I do have another one.
Yes, go ahead.
Also, we had a request to appoint a surfing committee to discuss the surfing rules in Ocean City, and that was requested by Councilman Dare that I bring forward the names to serve on that committee, and I'd like to bring forward those names tonight, and we tried to pick people that are part of that industry and also some business people and those that have, I think, would have good input on that particular situation. So my recommendation would be to appoint Shelley Dawson from the Surf Riders, Chris Shanahan from Keiko Surf Shop, Chris Tillman, Ocean City resident, Lee Jurakis from Malibu Surf Shop, Joe Groves from the Plaza Condominium, representing the Marva Condominium Managers Association, John Tremellin from the Princess Royale Hotel, Mick Chester, who has a surfing website, Rick Perro, who was on the original committee that discussed and made the recommendation for the surfing beaches in Ocean City, Greg Shockley, representing the Shoreham Hotel, Butch Arvin, captain of the Beach Patrol, Ward Kovacs, lieutenant, Beach Patrol, Tom Schuster, director of Park and Recreation, David Recor, city manager. And I would suggest, recommend that that committee work with the members of the Park and Recreation Advisory Board, which would be now Dennis Dare, Lloyd Martin, and Joe Matresik.
All right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Matresik.
Motion to approve the surfing committee presented by the mayor.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve the committees.
I have several questions, if I could.
Go ahead.
Yes, I think, just to clear one misconception while we're doing the ordinances and so forth, I think Mr. Grove said the intention of the previous majority was to disband the committees, which is not true. The intention was to include everybody on the council in the committees. Along those same lines, right now, by ordinance, everybody on the council is on the pension committee. So if you want to change that, you're going to have to change the ordinance.
I think Mr. Ayers is aware of that.
Okay, yes. I talked to him earlier. But so that was the intention, to have everybody hear all the information at the same time. Now, can I ask a few other questions here on these committees here, if I could? Being on the noise board for 22 years, there were several occasions, and I think Doug will remember these, where people that were on the board moved out of town but still had property in town, but they could no longer serve on the board. So my question is, are we now opening up these committees to non-voting residents or property owners?
These are different than the committees that are made up of the citizens that require that the citizen be members of the community living in Ocean City, like the Board of Zoning Appeals, the Planning and Zoning Commission, and those boards.
How is it different?
These are committees. Those are commissions.
Okay. Okay. If that's the difference, are the members of the committee going to get paid?
No.
It's a volunteer.
It's a volunteer? Okay.
Actually, all these are committees made up of council members or city employees, with the exception of the Tourism Commission and the Surfing Committee, which is really a citizen committee.
So just for record, so I understand, because this is the first time I've heard this, on a committee you don't have to live in town. You don't have to be a voter.
We could make it so everybody on the Surfing Committee would have to live in town.
Well, I think that would eliminate, as far as being a voter, I think that would eliminate several.
It would.
So it just seems to me you should have to.
I think the recommendation was to get representatives from the Surfing Committee. It's a different type of committee. But
okay.
Also, you know, we don't require that the representative from the HMRA or the chamber or those representatives be residents of Ocean City either.
So committee, you don't have to live here. Commission, you do.
In these. The other ones that are set forth as appointees to serve in the charter, the Board of Zoning Appeals, Planning and Zoning Commission, we look at those differently. Yes. They're making decisions. These are only making recommendations.
And how often do they meet?
That's up to the different committee or commission. Typically, the Police Commission, Tourism Commission, and Recreation Parks Committee, which are made up solely of city employees or members of this elected body, typically meet monthly. The others meet as needed basis.
So they'll be making recommendations to the council?
Yes.
Even though they're not voters in town?
Which ones?
On the Surfing Committee.
Yeah, if that's a real angst for you, we could change that and eliminate a lot of these people and make it so it's just citizens. If that's really, you know, Brent, I think the thing is to move forward here.
Well,
you want to go backwards?
Forward too,
we can go backwards.
It just seems to me you should have a stake in the community to.
Well, I think that we could do that. If you want me to redo that and cut these names out, I'd certainly be. No, I don't think I will do that, as a matter of fact. I'm going to move forward.
You've made your decision, so let us stand at that.
I'm going to move forward.
I look at the OCDC committee and how well it's worked downtown, and I know that you're in favor of the OCDC and how well it's done downtown, and not all those people live in town as well, but their heart's in town. They care about this town. And when you put this surfing community together and you look at these people, they have their heart that what's best for the town of Ocean City and the surfing community. I mean, they're going to volunteer their time. They're not being paid. They're going to make a recommendation to us, whether it's for the surfing beaches, the rotating beaches, whatever it may be. You want people that have their heart involved in this town and on these committees, and with the same thing with the OCDC, and you had your TAB board that you put together and you voted for. These people didn't live in town. But what they did is they brought recommendations to the council here, and you voted for that. There's no different here. The people are making their livelihood on TAB and the hotel motel business or whatever else. Here, some of them are making their business in the surfing community, in a surf shop. So we're trying to move forward with it.
That's strictly a citizen committee that's going to meet with members of the Marin City Council. It's really different.
I don't see where it's different from the committees, but okay.
All right. Any other discussion? I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight to move forward with the surfing committee. All those in favor? Vote is 5 in favor with 1 in opposition. Brent Ashley in opposition with Councilmember Pillis absent.
Thank you, Mr. President.
You're welcome, Mr. Marin. Got a little screwed up here. All right. Next on the agenda is the consent agenda is a request for Cane Woods Community Association to serve beer and wine at their best events. And they would be, the events would be at Fiesta Park Cleanup on April 13th, Cane Woods Community Picnic on June 22nd, August 6th for National Nights Out, and August 24th for the Fall Picnic. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Councilmember Steinbeck. All right, by a second. I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Simak. All those in favor? Vote is 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. All right, next on our agenda is a request from William Rothermill to approve concept for Eagle Scout service project. William, there you are.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for this opportunity. So my name is William Rothermill. I'm 14 and a member of Boy Scout Troop 261, which is the oldest Boy Scout troop in the Ocean City area. I've achieved the rank of life, and now I'm eligible to work on the rank of Eagle. And one of the primary components of getting Eagle is undertaking a project that enhances the welfare of the community. Well, because of my interests in the history of Ocean City, I would like to undertake the design, construction, and placement of historical markers in the downtown area. However, before I obtain approval by the Boy Scouts District Eagle representative, I must obtain the endorsement by the owner of the area that will be improved by the project. Currently, there are informational signs or markers overlooking the inlet which speak more than nature, and I would like to highlight at least 2 areas in the downtown Ocean City, and I'm open to suggestions for others. One location is where the train came into town, and the other is where the depot was located. I believe these markers will enhance the walkability and aesthetics of the downtown area. Therefore, I'm requesting the approval of the Mayor and City Council to proceed with this project. I received the endorsement of the Ocean City Museum Society, the Downtown Association, and the Ocean City Development Corporation. Once all the approvals are in place, I'll work with the museum, the Downtown Association, and the OCDC to develop the content and design of the marker. I will also undertake the raising of the funds necessary for construction. Once a design has been established, I will come back before you with an update on the actual design as well as actual locations. At that point, I would be looking for authorization to proceed, and I would be happy to answer any questions.
All right. We got a lot of lights up here. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll make a motion to approve.
All right. Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
Okay. I have a motion by Councilmember
I would add that, you know, that we will have final approval of the, if that will make that part of his motion.
Right.
Okay. Will do.
Yep.
Okay.
I have a motion by Councilmember Ashley and a second by Councilmember Matresik. Another light on. Councilmember Knight.
I was on for second.
All right. William, I tell you, before we take the vote, I got to tell you, you did a very good job, you know. And, yeah. And the Boy Scouts have done a good job. So I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're looking forward to seeing you again.
And I will request that the mayor would sign my
Certainly.
Service yep. project.
Not a problem. Yep.
Thank goodness the Boy Scouts got a unanimous vote.
All
So cool. Good luck. Very excited.
All right. Next on the agenda is the public hearing for FY 2014 Annual Transportation Grant, presented by Hal Atkins and George Thorne. George, welcome.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. As indicated, this is a once-a-year public hearing for the public relative to the transportation budget for FY14. There is a sign-in sheet behind me. When we are done, if you wish to speak, please make sure you leave your name and address when you leave the podium with the city clerk. Different this year than in past, you'll notice I do not have an assistant with me for the hearing impaired. In accordance with the MTA regulations, the advertisement that was run relative to this evening indicated if such assistance was necessary, please call in advance or reach out to us in advance. We received no requests, so I will be rolling this evening without an assistant. The presentation is broken down into two separate components. One deals with the operating budget. The second component will deal with the capital request. Kelly, there you go. The annual operating budget for FY14 is projected, as indicated, as $5,546,343. The overall operating budget is supported by a number of revenue sources, as indicated. And I'm going to go right on through them. Fare box revenue, $2,443,618. Advertising revenue relative to the bus wraps, both exterior, interior, and the roofs on the trams, $210,000 is projected for the coming year. The senior bus passes, which are sold, if I recall, in a two-year interval for $7, result in $8,638. We have discount coupon books, generates $172,708. Those are the coupon books for $15. You get 20 tickets. The service charges for Greyhound, many people now may not realize we work with Greyhound at the West Ocean City Park and Ride facility, where we operate as their ticketing agency. It brings in $21,808. And then, of course, the service charges that are received for what is known as MedTran in the amount of $13,000. And $15. In addition to that, we are supported by some operating grants. As indicated, we had a federal grant of $684,657, a state grant of $31,125, and what is known as an ADA grant for $110,000. I'd like to pause there just for 1 second for both the council's benefit and the citizens' benefit to let you know, relative to the operating grants, the combined amount of the $684,000 and $31,000 from the state has been a static number for the last 8 years, and the funding for our ADA grant at $110,000 has been a static number for the last 13 years. Okay. Next slide, please. Or bottom of that, the general fund contribution, as one of the citizens spoke at the beginning of the meeting, results in $1,850,774. This year's budget as presented for FY14 in comparison with FY13 is a reduction of roughly $77,000. One of the indicators when studying the performance of a transit system is what is known as your fare box recovery ratio. Your fare box recovery ratio is a comparison of your revenue stream versus your operating cost for a specific fixed route. I wanted to comment to the council and the citizens that when you look at the state of Maryland as a whole and you look at the systems relative to sheer ridership, we come in fourth. The MTA in Baltimore has the highest ridership, followed by Montgomery County, followed by PG, followed by Ocean City. When you look at fare box recovery ratios from a performance stance and standards that we are required to comply with the state, it is considered to be successful if you have a fare box recovery ratio that exceeds 25%. The MTA in Baltimore has a fare box recovery ratio of 36%. Montgomery County has a fare box recovery ratio of 20%.
PG County has a farebox recovery ratio of 10%. Ocean City has a farebox recovery of 45.77%, to show you where we compare to these other agencies, regardless of what your current general fund subsidy is at $1.85 million. Next slide, please. Capital. Each year, we put a list of items together and they were requested to the state for consideration. As indicated, that is this year's list. We are requesting 29 buses. The reality is noted below in parentheses that we have been told in advance that we will most likely receive 6. The manner in which we go about determining which buses need replacement deals with federal criteria for what is known as useful life criteria. Giving you an example, on a typical 40-foot bus, the useful life criteria, by definition, is 12 years in age or in excess of 500,000 miles. When reviewing our fleet of 62 pieces, we currently have 29 that have met or exceeded the useful life criteria. As indicated, we envision we'll be receiving 6. If I do some quick math, I think that comes to roughly $454,000 per bus. Going down the list further, renovation to the North End Transit Center. My, I feel like I just built that yesterday, but in reality, it was built in 2006. Preventive maintenance on our rolling stock, $600,000. Renovation of the Park and Ride Transit Center. Again, I feel like I built it yesterday. That was 2001, if I recall. Preventive maintenance contract for the money room, preventive maintenance contract on the overhead doors to the bus barn. That bus barn was built in 1983 and opened in 1984. And then purchased passenger shelter parts. Grand total from the left column is $13,891,000, which would normally be a 90-10 split. But if I recall, there's another line of data that should pop up here in a second based on anticipated funding. $3,449,000, a 90-10 split. Our local match would be $344,900, which in fact is factored in to the overall FY14 budget that has been submitted as a reduction of roughly $77,000 from the previous year. That concludes the presentation. If there are any questions from the council or the citizens, I'm open to them.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Do you know how
come on, come up to this. Come up to the mic, sir.
It's just a quick.
No, it's a public hearing. That way, everybody can hear what you're saying.
You know how we stack up with deficit as a percentage of budget. You gave, in other words, 1.8 over roughly 5 something.
Mm-hmm.
You were comparing us on another measure. I'm just curious how we stacked up. Operational deficit as a percentage of total cost.
I can't sit there and answer that for you right now. Again,
I'm just curious.
Yeah, is it Mr. Chris? Yeah, let me just show you something real quick, and I'll be glad to share this with the council. There are certain criteria that we monitor, of course, relative to state. So those are the categories I have memorized. But I could look at it your way if you like. Try to get you an answer.
Well, I didn't mean to create. I just thought if you had that would be interesting as a percentage of the budget, what the deficit is.
I do not.
Pretty easy.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Anybody else in the public? Yes, ma'am.
State your name. State your name.
Yeah. Make sure you restate.
L.A. Diggleman, 106 120th Street, Ocean City, Maryland. okay. It says the town contribution is $77,223 less this year than last year.
Correct.
Okay. I don't know what the figure was for last year, but what I do have is that the figure was, I think, $1.75 million for FY12. I don't know if that's right. And I got that from last week's City Council agenda, work session agenda, page 99. So I hope I've read that right. And I was just trying to find out what the FY13 figure was for last year. This year's is $1,857.74.
The best way to answer you, if you look at the overall operating budget, all revenues, everything in, mm-hmm. What I'm trying to tell the council of citizens is that the overall budget we have submitted is $77,000 and change less than the previous year. If you want to focus in on the general fund contribution that was on one of these slides, which was noted as $1,850,774. The general fund contribution for FY14 in comparison to FY13, which was $1,927,997.
Right. And then 12 was 1.75 something?
That was the end result after the whole year closed out, 1.5 and change.
Okay. I guess what my concern is how it's going to affect our pockets, notwithstanding all the rest of the factors that are involved here. I'm just concerned that we can't afford it because all these other expenses that we have that are being bonded out and all that kind of stuff, we're just going further and further in debt. And it's not that we don't need the buses or whatnot. I realize we need them, but we just can't continue to go on borrowing and bonding and everything else and living outside of our means and living outside of our children's and grandchildren's and great-grandchildren's means. That's my concern.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Your name and address.
Joseph B. Cryer, 709 Gulfstream Drive, Ocean City, Maryland. Just from my observation, I think transportation is a loss. We have to pay for it. So I don't know how we're going to pay for it, but to make affordable transportation for people on the island, I don't see where we could run a profit. So just my initial swag at it is that we're going to lose money, but how much are we going to lose and how it's going to benefit the community? So that's my thought on transportation. So I'd love to beat him up and say, you know, you're making too much money and yada, 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 but it's just not the case. I mean, we're losing money on it, and we have to pay the bill. So,
thank you. All right. One more.
John Atkins, 8802 Caribbean Drive. I got two suggestions. One, having rode the bus a lot, if we could put something inside the bus on a sign that shows how much actually comes out of the general fund and what it costs us to operate the system. If we could put a small sign that passengers and people could read to know that we pay almost $2 million to operate this system out of our general fund that the local taxpayers subsidize, I think would be something that maybe the people would try to understand what it costs to operate that system, even though they're only paying $3 or a dollar. The next suggestion, and comes to Hal, is we have a $600,000 maintenance budget, which I'm sure is reasonable for the fleet that we operate. One suggestion I have is looking at installing synthetic oil in the buses and using bypass oil filters, which will take it down to like 3 microns, and that's 3 millionths of an inch. You can't, it's thinner than a human hair. But I've used this system on my truck, and I know it works. I know it works on commercial trucks where they change oil every 50 to 60,000 miles. And I'm sure that we do it a lot sooner than that. But it's something I would like for the city staff and for the council to consider. Synthetic oil is about $5 or $6 a quart compared to $1.50 for regular oil. But I've been using synthetic oil, which doesn't have carbon in it, doesn't burn. Been using it since 1979, long time. And the engines will not wear out as soon.
Is that on the same truck?
Nope. Two or three trucks. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Okay. Anyone else to pick it? Yes, sir.
I asked a question a few moments ago, and I want to put the buses in that context because you're going to make me feel easier if you guys start to view things in this context. It's not only the $1.8 million and what I got from what Hal said. It's the replacement cost per year, which is over 500,000 miles, what the proration of that is every year. It's all of the expenses to keep it in existence. So the $1.8 million may actually be $4 or $5 million a year. Then the question not only becomes how do we get the $1.8 million, I mean, there's a limit to these things. And that's a correct way you have to look at your expenses. You can't look at them as that dead number of $1.8 million. And that's why I'm trying to help. I'm willing to help with it, too. But you need to get, you need to know what the expenses are.
Thank you. All right. Anyone else who speak at the public hearing? If not, Councilmember Steinbeck.
Mr. President, I make a motion that we close the public hearing.
Councilmember Matresi.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Steinbeck and a second by Councilmember Matresi to close the public hearing. All those in favor? Vote is 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Councilmember Dare.
Mr. President, while we're on the subject, but not as part of the public hearing, I share the concern about the $1.8 million that Mr. Chris talks about for the town. Where, and as Mr. Atkins mentioned, 50% of the less than 50% of the fare box pays for the transportation department. So the state and federal grants pay for 15%, and as Mr. Atkins mentioned, that's been capped for a number of years. So that means that the taxpayers are paying 33%. I've followed in the newspaper the predicament that the state's in with the transportation fund, and they're looking for ways to address that. And I'd just like to ask that the mayor, and as our liaison with Annapolis, and keep in mind that as they may contact him through this process, that it might be an opportunity for the state to finally consider Ocean City as an urban provider and act accordingly. So as some changes are occurring up there, perhaps there's an opportunity for us to be finally addressed in the proper context.
Thank you.
It's a good idea. Yep.
Could I add, if I could add to that comment, because over the years, Dennis and I had that discussion, and I had once before supported it. You know, it'd be nice if we could move forward and look into it. What we will find out, it may end up being both a state and federal issue, because we are a Section 53 rural provider by federal definition. The definition is tied to your census population. Your census population is less than 50,000. You fall into that box. Doesn't mean you can't change the box.
All right, we'll look into that. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you. Okay. All right. Next on the agenda is items referred to in presentation from the city solicitor. Guy?
Ordinance 2013-2 for second reading amends Chapter 39 entitled Franchises of the Code of the Town of Ocean City. The net effect of this ordinance would change the prohibited area of vending where it used to be east of Baltimore Avenue from 18th Street South. It's now east of Baltimore Avenue from 27th Street South to the inlet.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Matresi.
Motion to approve ordinance 2013-2 on second reading.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Discussion? All those in favor? I have 6 in favor with Councilmember Pills absent. Thank you.
For first reading, ordinance 2013-3, ordinance to adopt FY13 budget amendment number 1.
All right. Councilmember Matresi.
Motion to approve.
All right. Councilmember Simek?
Second.
All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Matresi and a second by Councilmember Simek. All those in favor? Votes are 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Thank you, guys. All right.
For first reading, ordinance 2013-4, ordinance to amend Chapter 110 entitled Zoning. It permits miniature golf as a conditional use in the downtown mixed-use zoning district.
Councilmember Ashley.
Motion to approve.
Councilmember Simek.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Ashley and a second by Councilmember Simek. All those in favor? Vote of six in favor with Councilmember Pillows absent. Okay.
First reading ordinance to amend, ordinance 2013-5 amends Chapter 110 entitled Zoning. It clarifies the calculation of required parking for mixed-use developments.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve.
A motion by Councilmember Knight. Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresik. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote of six in favor with Councilmember Pillows absent.
Kelly, I need a resolution number.
Yes, sir.
Maybe one, or maybe it's two.
It's two.
Two. The ordinance, I'm sorry, resolution 2013-2 is an ordinance authorized, or I'm sorry, a resolution authorizing the sale of surplus personal property, which are four trolley-style buses. And let me explain something on this.
Please.
Since a member came up earlier and spoke about this transaction, you need to understand these trolleys were purchased with federal and state funds 90%. Town's contribution was 10%. And just because the town no longer has a use for these trolleys within our transportation system, as far as the formula or whatever the federal government uses to determine the useful life of the vehicle, these trolleys are considered to still have a useful life. They're only eligible to be transferred to an entity that's eligible for federal and state grants for transportation. And we are only allowed to get 10% of the appraised value. If you want to equate it to something, it would be like the book value, the blue book value of a typical motor vehicle or truck that anyone purchased. These vehicles have been appraised. 10% of the value of these, of each of these vehicles is $6,690. The transfer is to two entities that I don't know whether we've had the approval yet. We have to get the approval of both the MTA and the FTA, but they are eligible for grants from those entities. A member of the general public is not eligible for a grant. It could not purchase these buses. We're not allowed to take 90% federal and state funds and flip the buses and make a profit. So that's why this is the amount. This is, if you'll recall, is the exact same transaction we did about a year ago when we sold four trolleys to the city of Annapolis.
All right. Thank you, Guy. Thanks for the explanation. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve.
Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresik. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote of six in favor with Councilmember Pillows absent. All right.
We have resolution 2013-3. The resolution authorizing the city manager to file an application with the Maryland Transit Administration for grant money. Again, based on this resolution is in support of the public hearing that was just held by Mr. Adkins. A speaker advised that why are we doing this since the MTA didn't have any grant money? Well, we don't know whether they'll have grant money or not, and that money gets funneled through the federal government, and we don't know whether they'll have grant money or not. But if you don't ask for it, you're not going to get it. And just because you ask for it doesn't mean you are going to get it.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve.
Councilmember Simek.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Simek to approve the resolution. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote of six in favor with Councilmember Pillows absent.
We have resolution 2013-4. The resolution granting a food, beverage, and merchandise franchise to the OC Air Show LLC. This is a franchise that we grant every year for the air show. It allows them to have the commercial ventures out on the beach in certain areas of town that are designated in the resolution. We do it by franchise because that's the way our code allows for this type of activity within 75 feet of the boardwalk.
Okay. Councilmember Matresik.
Motion to approve Resolution 2013-4.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve Resolution 2013-4. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote of 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. One more again. Moving along.
The next item would be a general order for the Ocean City Police Department. It would be general order 400D-2. It's an amendment to the existing general order dealing with how the police department deals with individuals with disabilities under the ADA requirements. The revisions mainly deal with service animals.
All right. Okay, Council. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll make a motion to approve.
All right. Got a motion by Councilmember Ashley.
Yeah.
Councilmember Simak.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Ashley and a second by Councilmember Simak to approve the general order 400D2. Discussion? All those in favor? Vote of 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. All right. Next on the agenda is comments from the city manager. It's a review of tentative March 12, 2013 work session. David?
Thank you, Mr. President, Mayor, Council members. We have a work session scheduled for Tuesday, March 12, 2013. Prior to the regularly scheduled work session, we also have a closed session scheduled from 12 to 1 to discuss legal and personnel matters. We have several items of new business on the tentative agenda, beginning with the presentation of pedestrian safety awareness campaign from Karen Wagner, the Eastern Shore Regional Traffic Safety Program Manager for Maryland Motor Vehicle Administration. We will also receive an annual update from Clint Irwin with the Ocean City Development Corporation, as well as the President of the Board. We will receive an update from our Parks and Recreation Department. I've also asked the Director of Emergency Services, Joe Theobald, to present a follow-up report to the training that we received in Emmitsburg on the Integrated Emergency Management course. That will be followed by a quarterly report from the Fire Department presented by Chief Larmore. As I mentioned to you earlier today, met with the chief for a good while today, several hours, and it's a very, very good report, very, very well done, very thorough, and I know you all will look forward to that. We have a presentation from our finance administrator regarding the consideration of a proposal to provide credit debit card payment options for our bus customers, P-Money. And last item on the tentative agenda is the city clerk has a request to approve changes to policy in the procedure manual regarding banner location within the town limits.
All right. Thank you, David.
You're welcome.
All right. Next on the agenda is comments from the council. Councilmember Matresik.
Well, I would just like to, those of you knew I had a little incident last week. I'd like to thank everyone who sent me well wishes and prayers. And to thank the staff of the paramedics and EMTs once again publicly. Hopefully none of you will ever know just how good they are. That's one thing that I can hope for all of you. But they are extremely professional, and I owe quite a debt to them. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. All right. Councilmember Ashley.
Mr. Recor. Last week there was apparently, and I don't know whether this is hush-hush or I don't know what the story is, but because I haven't heard from anybody, but there was an email sent about those cheerleading groups to the convention center. It was a potential loss of millions of dollars. It was possible. I didn't know anything about it until I read it in the paper. And last I heard, it was still up in the air. Can you give us an update on that? I mean, I don't know. Like I said, I have no personal knowledge of it other than what I read in the paper, and the reporters knew more than I did, and I've got constituents calling me, and I don't know what to tell them.
Want me to answer?
Yeah, sure. Mr. Mayor, go ahead.
There was a, David and I did receive, well, there was an email, and there was some concern, and we were kind of surprised at the email, and talked to the director of the convention center, Larry Nocolino, and he was having a conference call with the principals from Epic.
Epic Productions,
who are the promoters of the cheerleading event, and he asked if David and I would come up and sit on that convention, on that conference call. And during that call, we had the opportunity, which was really a good opportunity, to discuss with them the new auditorium or performing arts center, which it doubles as, of course, and their ability to utilize that. And they had a couple concerns, and we're in the very final phases of architectural design. I mean, it's really finished, but we can make changes. And they had some concerns about being able to use that because of the depth of the stage and the height of the, persimmon, I think it is.
Persimmon wall.
Yes, and wanted to make sure that it would be able to accommodate their event. And we were able to show them how, with some minor modifications, which was good to know at that time, that first area of seating in front of the stage is not permanent seating. And those seats can be removed, and we can actually extend that stage out, which would accommodate what they need. So Terry McGeehan is working to make sure that that's done. The height was already okay. There shouldn't be any modifications needed, but if there were, that was something that you can do. You know, it didn't make any difference, really. It was just a matter of where you put it. And the other concern they had was where their judges might sit. And the first level of raised seating is actually the handicap seating area, and that seating is going to be removable seating, and it's an area that would accommodate all their needs. So they were very excited about being part of the process. I think they felt that now they could be assured that they have a great spot for in the future to utilize, probably the best stage they'll have in the convention center. And they're coming back down, as they always do, as a follow-up after their event in April. And it was very positive, and I think they're anxious to come back, and they stated that, and they think they'll be able to work that out.
But at this point, there's no final agreement that they're going to renew the contract for the next 3 years? Is that what it was?
No, but they typically, that's what I think they'll do when they come back, as they typically would, to meet.
Okay.
But it was positive. You know, you can throw out negative, and, you know, you can try to throw out misinformation, which I think happened. You know, rather than, you know, we have a lot of partners in town, and rather than working with us, sometimes it's almost like they work against us.
Well, I would request, as a council member, that anything like this happens, I would like to get an update from somebody, because I got people calling me and I don't know what to tell them other than read the newspaper.
Yeah. Okay. I think David did. Didn't you do that?
No. Generally, that would have been a bullet in my Friday report. But as I mentioned earlier, with the Art League reception, the Friday bullet list did not go out.
That's where I thought it was going to be put.
Well, but this happened before Friday, David. No, I mean, it was in the paper Friday.
Well,
so apparently it happened on Tuesday. They got the email, I believe.
There was an email, and I think the takeaway from this is that the good communication and responsiveness of the staff before Friday had resolved the issue. There are issues like this that come up in the course of, you know, running this $100 million company, if you look at it as a business, in the course of the week that require, you know, constant decision making. And so, yes, the issue came up earlier in the week. We immediately scheduled the conference call with the event promoter, which they were receptive. And before Friday, we had resolved the issue through good, effective communication. We also learned that should also be reaching out to the other event promoters that have booked the convention center to involve them in a similar dialogue. And Larry Nocolino will be doing just that. We followed up with the media on Thursday afternoon following that conference call to avoid further negative press. And I apologize and take full responsibility for not informing the council. But to be honest with you, I mean, it was just like any other issue that comes up during the week, we addressed it, and, you know.
Well, but it's not, because when you're talking potentially millions of dollars lost in revenue for these hotels and so forth, and the people calling me,
I didn't know what to tell them.
You can send them to me.
Well, but I'm supposed to know.
You can.
Okay, I should be able to say, well, this has happened, that has happened. So I don't know about the effect of communications because I was out of loop entirely.
I agree with that.
And it was very embarrassing to tell people in the community, I don't know anything about it. Read the papers, though.
So. Well, in any event, if any of you have questions about and receive those kinds of inquiries from your constituents on something that you don't have information on, I hope you know you can always call me, and if I don't have the answer, I'll get to the bottom of it.
Okay.
But we tried. We thought we were staying on top of it, being proactive by scheduling that conference call. And at the end of the conversation, it seemed like everything was righted and moving in the right direction. So
good. Okay.
Well, thank you, David. You know, and I want the council to know, and I heard it from you, and you know, and you've been very responsive. At any time that anybody's ever called you, you always either didn't know the answer and got the answer and got back to us right away. And it's very important that you do that, and you've always have done that. So, Brent, I want to make sure that if you get those calls, make sure that if you don't know, call David right away.
Well, it was too late. They were already calling me.
I understand. I didn't get the email either. And, you know, some other people were in the loop with the email. You know what? I don't think David got the email that went around, okay, as well. And he didn't hear it until secondhand. So, but at the same time, you know, you have a staff here that works for you, okay?
I understand
and if
that.
You don't have that answer, call and ask. So, I mean, that's what I'm going to make sure that, you know, David hears loud and clear. But
well,
I think he said it very, very clearly. He works for you. And I think hopefully they resolve the issue and they're working through it. So.
And normally I agree with you. This was like huge with the phone calls I got. I went out to breakfast on Saturday morning. I was like,
what was meant to be
blocked in.
Yeah, well,
okay, normally I agree with you, but something that apparently the business community thinks is really huge, let me know.
Yes, sir. Well, I didn't know about it either until somebody came in and talked to me about it.
Absolutely.
All right.
We'll do that.
Okay. Anybody else on the council?
No.
Mr. Mayor.
And I agree with Brent, and I think if you'd have done your, you know, typical Friday notes, that would have been in there and everything. And those things do, news travels fast.
It's been too late Friday.
Sometimes you got to keep up with it. Yeah. We need to keep everybody up to date. It's difficult sometimes. I just wanted to try to end tonight on a high note. I attended, as many of you did, the opening of the new Art League building that the city manager mentioned on Friday night. And what a tremendous success. The community was definitely behind this venture. There were between 400 and 500 people that attended that grand opening. The facility is fantastic. It's a tremendous asset to the Art League, to the arts, to the town, the community, residents, visitors. I know that I was talking to the director of Parks and Recreation. He's already working with the Art League to do some of their senior pottery classes there because they have the facilities to do that exceed what we currently have. So I think there's going to be multiple uses, but it was very well attended. It was a wonderful event. Jeff and Rena Thaler and all the board of directors and the members of the Art League should be very proud of this success, as should the community, because this was really something that was done for us. It was done for the community. We supported it. No, Worcester County supported it, and so did many individuals with funding. So it was a fabulous opening. This building is going to serve all of us very well. And if you haven't had an opportunity to go up and take a look, please go up and take a look. I think you'll be very proud of this new addition to Ocean City. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to adjourn.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Marchesic. All those in favor? Vote is 6 in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Meeting adjourned.